With relating to God at war, some of you have expressed difficulty with it. Is that correct? All right, now, I don't know about you, but there are some reviews in the Google. Who's Googled God at war? I know it's difficult, the book, and as I've said to you, I'm fortunate I couldn't buy it in Australia. They were totally out of stock. One company said that they're out of print, but evidently it's not. So I haven't read the book, but I've been looking at it, doing a bit of research today on this book, because I haven't had the chance to see Sister Winnie King. But when you Google it and then you come up with God at War, of course you can look up quite a few good reviews. In fact, the book has a lot of good reviews on it. And so I can understand why this book was chosen for you to do it. So, but, I mean, you can't write these reviews as your assignment, please, you know, that's cheating. And in the academic world, if you do that, they soon discover it, because they'll just type in a few sentences of your assignment and bingo, up it'll come the computer and they'll fail you. That's what they do in the academic field.
Yeah.
You understand that? You know about that?
Yeah.
Well, that is a fact. And so because I'm doing certain studies for my master's and to get into my master's, so I've had to learn all these things. So, but to help you comprehend what God of War is about, it's a good book, and really it pinpoints the fact that God is not the author of evil. And it deals with the first section of the book in the Old Testament, it brings our situation, and then the New Testament. There was only one review that I found. There's one guy who couldn't quite grasp it, but there was a lot of you which basically, it had over 4 stars in response to it. So I'm not going to read them out. You can do your own computer work, all right? And to help you understand the book, maybe it might be just easy for you to read the reviews and then forget the computer, read the book, and then do your own work. But if you can have
have a grasp of understanding what a book is because it is an academic piece of work. And therefore, one review had as one person who had to have two dictionaries beside them when they read the book, because certain words were just, you just couldn't understand them. That's all right. You should read some of the journals I have to read. Absolutely wonderful. And you can't understand a quarter of it because the words are so fancy and they're not even in the dictionary. And so, you know, I could find out you get along with this book because it's a big book. And if you do have a certain time limit, you don't have to copy it anyway. But I'm just trying to help you, you know, get on so that once you understand something, it's easier to grasp. Got it? So if you want to do a little bit of Googling, go for it, but I don't know anybody else. That is relating step five, to speak. And it is a challenge to, you know, stop speaking your own language and all of a sudden you start saying a different language. And it takes a step of faith. And that's why the mind sometimes plays tricks. And, you know, I can see people always referring back to their mind. I can see it happening. And so I have to keep telling them, forget about what you're thinking, it comes out in the spirit. And, but the other thing that I do, and I know some people don't agree with it, but I have found it to be successful, I speak softly in tongues in the candidate's ears. You probably noticed me doing that last month. I just use my own prayer language because there are common prayer languages and that God uses. And that helps them just to formulate certain words so they can just start. It's only for the purpose to get them going. And I encourage them, okay, start speaking it out, and then what I do is I withdraw from them so that they will then continue speaking, and I tell them, keep speaking, let it flow out, and I tell them, okay, now what I'm doing is I'm making them rely upon their own faith. Okay? You understand that? That's important. And we do that as mums and dads with our kids. When we teach them how to speak, you know. My daughter, I had three daughters, and when we want them to say dada, you know, who tells them dada? I do. Because I want them to tell me dada. Isn't that true? You do it in your language. But so they follow you. And of course, after a while, they're on their own steam, and off they go, and women never shut up after. I grew up with four women in my household, don't worry about it. I love them all. Okay, say, you got the point. I speak softly in their ear, just speaking in tongues softly. I don't scream and yell like some people do. I've seen people at the altar call and lay hands upon them, and I've seen them shout in tongues, and I see the poor candidate just about want to do this. You know, it turns them off. I said, that's what it's all about. They said, let me out of here. You know, you've got to be able to appeal to them and encourage them so they will respond. So that's why I always talk softly in one of their ears, and hopefully they're not deaf. And then withdraw myself and keep encouraging them to do that. And of course, our two brothers here, they're excited tonight. They've come back really with a smile on their faces, and rejoicing in what God has done for them last night. So that's a tremendous victory, isn't it? Amen?
Amen.
All right, before I do the rest, anything else with the rest of the book, I just want to turn your attention to 1 Kings, 2 Kings chapter 4. I want to just talk about a story from the Bible. You'll understand why I picked this story, because this is an important story. Because here's a woman who was in debt and was going to lose her two sons. You know the story quite well, correct? And this woman, of course, she was a wife of one of the prophets, and all of a sudden, of course, her husband died. For whatever reason, he got a line out and used as a, according to the culture of the day, they were quite happy to use their children as a guarantor that the debt would be paid. And if the debt wasn't paid, then the children would be taken as slaves. Now, of course, in basic terms, she had a need. And of course, her need was she was going to lose her two sons. And knowing the fact that she was a wife of a prophet, knowing the fact that she had spiritual knowledge, ways of the Lord. And of course, as a mentor, as a prophet, and Elisha able to guide and direct her ways with her husband. I mean, that must have had a great teaching from the school of the prophets. But she had a need. Her husband died, and she couldn't pay the debt. And so she went to the prophet, and you know the story. Then not only did she have a need, but she had a resource. And that resource was a jar of oil. And of course, oil is typical of what in the Bible? Holy Spirit. Oil is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. That's right throughout the Bible. You'll notice that. So you'll understand what I'm going to get at. So here she is, and the prophet talks to her and said, okay, what's your problem? And so she tells in her plight that she's going to lose her son, the creditor is coming. And so what she's going to do? And the prophet had to use a little bit of wisdom to get her to refocus away from the debt. And refocus on the fact that, you know, there was more at stake here than just her debt. Because if, imagine Elisha, if he just took out his checkbook and wrote out a check, and says, hey, I know your husband has served the Lord well, and you know, they even, and so he said, here's a blessing, and you can pay your debt, and you're right now from now on. Amen? That would have been easy, wouldn't it? For Elisha to do. But he realized that that would be the biggest mistake he could ever do. Hallelujah. The biggest mistake. Because she had a greater need. And that greater need was, how is she going to live for the rest of her life? She lost everything. House is empty. No tables, no chairs. She sold everything. She was so desperate. She even sold the beds. And finally, when she had nothing in the house, she went to the prophet. because the prophet understood the wisdom of not meeting an immediate need. But she had to understand there's something about that resource that she had to become involved with. And this is why I want to lead you down the path in a moment about our relationship with the Holy Spirit. And so, of course, the prophet was wise and said to her, okay, you go home, start knocking on the door, get some bats, get some pots, borrow as many pots as you like. And then go home, bring them home, you and your sons, and shut the door. Now take that one jar of oil, that resource, soak, and then start pouring it out. Now she had to make, so she had a need, she had a resource, she had to make room for God to move in her life. She knew about God, she knew the ways of God. She was instructed by one of the greatest prophets there was. And in her making room for God, she was obedient to the prophet's voice. So she went and collected as many pots as she could, brought them home, shut the door, as the prophet said. And I can imagine one of the boys saying, well, okay, Mum, what are we going to do now with all these pots? Well, the prophet said, let's get that little jar of oil that's on the shelf in the kitchen, and let's start pouring. That's bad, Mum. You know, that's not going to go very far. What do you think you're going to do? Mum says, I don't know. I don't know what the prophet said. The word of God said. The prophet was the man of God, and what he declared was the word of God. That's how they viewed the prophet. And so whatever came out of the mouth, that was the word of the Lord. And she said, that's what God said. That's what we're going to do. We're going to just pour and believe. So she did. And as you know the story. All right, she filled all the pots with oil. When it came to the last one, the oil stopped flowing. Now, she went back to the prophet. And the prophet said, okay, divide the oil pots, keep so many for yourselves, and sell the rest, pay your debt, and live happily ever after. See, the prophet was wise because the greater need was met, as well as the immediate need. Amen. Sometimes we have people come to us and they beg and they tell you all sorts of stories. I tell you, I want to make you weep. I had an email yesterday. I want to make you weep about this woman. Can you please? You know, she tells all of her stories. She's in hospital. She's dying. She's this and she's that. I said, believe. That's one good thing about the computer. You can just believe it. Hallelujah. But you see, God was wise. It's like when I've had people come to my door, you know, drunkards, oh, look, I haven't eaten for 3 days. Oh, can you please give me some money for some food? You've had that happen. Come on, it happens to every pastor. It will do if you haven't had it happen. So they come home, I want money, I want some money just to buy some food. And I said, sorry, I'm not in the business of handing out money, but if you're hungry, I'll take you down to McDonald's and I'll give you a meal. Oh, no, just give me money, I'll be right. So, you know, as soon as you give money, they'll go to the pub and drink it. That's why I never give money. I always offer a meal if they're hungry. Amen? It's just like, you know, if I gave a fish to that brother that's here, go and cook yourself a meal, I mean, tomorrow, or a couple of days' time, he's going to come back and say, look, you know, I enjoyed that fish. You know, how about I've been 2 days without food, and I have another fish? Well, I would be silly to give him another fish. But if I took a fishing rod and taught him how to fish, he'd be catered for the rest of his life. Correct? We've got to use a little bit of wisdom sometimes in what we do and how we minister to people's needs. But anyway, coming back to this story, the importance of this story is simply this. Our relationship with the Holy Ghost. Let's go a little bit deeper into her life and you'll begin to grasp something else. they breathe the atmosphere of the court. They have servants to do everything. They had parties galore. The social lifestyle was one of superabundance, and she enjoyed that lifestyle. Now, for whatever reason, the husband, you know, he ended up being short of cash, so he had to get this loan. And here she is, enjoying every bit of a high society of life, and then all of a sudden, she finds herself with a dead husband. No way to pay the bill. You see, when you realize the extremity of what she went through, you can understand the story with a greater enlightenment. And so when she had a need, because she had to go and live in the village, find a little home, took what she had in furniture, and then because she didn't have finances, she went through the process of selling everything off. Of course, the people in the community knew who she was. Knew that here was a woman that actually had nothing to do with anybody else in the village, and she used to shun them because, you know, she was living the upper high style life, the upper class lifestyle. And here she is, now living amongst the villagers. People looking on. Then, of course, when she gets to desperation, now she has to learn how to participate and use the resource that she had in her room, in the kitchen, that little jar of oil. She had no idea what the prophet was going to say, but she went to the prophet, as you know. The prophet said, use the oil. Go out, borrow pots. And you can imagine her, you know, she had to knock on every door, and people that were looking on, ready to scorn her. She had to beg for pots. Never done this in her life. She only had servants. They did everything for her. And here she is, knocking on every door. You can imagine knocking on the first door, she knocks on the door, and the door opens, Mr. Zabedia. Yeah, I know all about you. Yeah, you used to live up there in the palace, eh? What's it like to live with us? And she said, I hear rumors about you, and you know your sons are going to be repossessed. What's it feel like to live our lifestyle? Because she begs for a pipe. She may get one, but the door slams in her face. But she does this over and over again. Some doors, just people slam in her face. What do you think this takes? This takes the discipline of commitment. And our relationship with the Holy Spirit is going to take discipline. For her to knock on the doors, for her to beg for pots, for her to actually go out and knock was the hardest thing in her life. But she did. She was laughed at, she was scorned. People abused her. How does she deserve everything that she got? But she made a commitment to obey the voice of the Lord. And here was the involvement coming in with the resource of the Holy Spirit. Because we need to get involved with what God has given us, this precious gift, the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that's why the prophet was wise. You say, I'm not going to help her and dish out the money, because I'm going to use and get her to recognize that this oil is the key to release her into the superabundance of what God has for this precious life and its two children.
And it is the same with the blessed Holy Spirit. He is the key. He is the focal point. That as we become totally connected and involved with Him, He's the one that will bring us into super abundance. And so she did. When she finished knocking on all the doors, and she closed the door. And there's one thing about the Holy Spirit that you cannot avoid, and that is your relationship has to be first in private. First in private. You don't show off and tell people what you do, how long you pray for, and all the rest of it. How, you know, tell people how super spiritual you are. That's not the way that the Holy Spirit works. He wants us to follow the spirit of humility, and our relationship must be behind closed doors. That's where your intimacy with the Holy Spirit must prevail. You must get involved with every part, pouring out oil in every part. And she looked at those pots, and you can imagine names on the pots, because she had to return them. And as she poured the oil in, you can imagine her blessing that pot and blessing that woman. And yes, she cursed her. She did all those things to her. She said those bad words to her. But here she is pouring oil into her life. More to this woman than one meets the eye. So she got so involved in sharing, ministering in the intimacy of the Holy Spirit. And in that intimacy, she was blessing others. She was blessing others. And that's what the Holy Spirit is. It's not for ourselves. Can you imagine after the oil was finished and things started to happen, and she went to the market and took the pots and sold them, and then she started knocking on the doors and brought the pots clean back to the people, and they said, what have you been doing? I've been seeing, you know, people come to your house. I've been seeing, you know, you've been buying new furniture. What's happening? You can imagine the story she had to tell. And how she poured the oil in, and how she prayed for you. I prayed for you, I blessed you in Jesus' name. She touched that community like no other person could. Why? Because she had an intimacy and got involved and connected into the work of the Holy Spirit. And that's our challenge in all of the supernatural that God wants us to get involved with. It all starts with your and my relationship with the Holy Spirit. You can't deny that fact. That is the number one and most important priority in your life. Intimacy with the Holy Spirit. More important than your own. You know, God has to be number one in your life. Then comes our partner. Then comes your ministry. And put your family in front of your ministry. That's not the way God works. You must always put your family before the ministry. Amen? The intimacy with the Holy Spirit. And by the time she finished selling all the oil and paid all the debt off, and got all the new furniture in the house after it looked brand spanking new, you can imagine how the community looked on with envy. How the Lord, they see the Lord's blessing. And when they get the pots, they get blessed because they loan her a pot and they receive a blessing. I think it's so wonderful. And there will be times when people will look at you and think you're probably spending too much time in prayer. When I was in Bible school, I was one of the first ones out. I was in the same boat as you guys. No, some of you are not in Bible school. I was in Bible school. I boarded in the dormitory. I had four guys to one room. So I had to share my one room with three other men. That was a challenge. Having to live with three other men. And they're all so different to you. And I used to get up real early before everybody else, and I used to go down into our prayer room, and I used to seek the Lord. Guys used to notice. I never said anything to anybody. But guys noticed people, they noticed, and they talk. And then they used to come and tell me, he said, Bill, you said you're going to have a nervous breakdown. You better not pray so much. Bible school, telling me that. You see, I had a passion. And that passion was the Lord Himself. I wanted to have the intimacy with Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And that meant more to me than anything else, and that sustained me through my years in Bible school. Intimacy. And all those guys who ridiculed me, you know, none of them lasted in the ministry. You wonder why? Those guys who sought the Lord, those guys who put God first, those guys who spent time in the presence of God, they're the ones that stuck. They're the ones still in the ministry today. There is a price to pay when it comes to our intimacy with the Holy Spirit. Just like this woman. But it brought great benefits and great blessing into her life. And I believe that great blessing will come into all of our lives because of it. Amen? Chuck. Lord's been speaking to me about you. Your future is an interesting one. Because even though you haven't got a full picture of what you want God to do, but you're going to get doors open. You're a type of person, and God opens the door, you give it your best shot. You're committed, you love the Lord. He says, don't accept every opportunity. Be careful. Because the enemy is going to come. He's going to make an offer for you. An opportunity. It's going to look so good for you. The benefits of that ministry is going to absolutely blow you apart. Because he says, be careful. Don't just jump in. Don't jump in. You need to surround yourself with wise counselors, wise men, and seek their wisdom and their counsel. Because your ministry, you have a great ministry. You're going to touch people, many people. I can see crowds of people that are going to be responsive to your ministry. But you have to be careful, because if you jump in at the wrong opportunity, your life will be messed up. Okay? I see this as plain as day. And if you can avoid this by simply being very careful, not to jump in at every opportunity, but to seek the Lord and seek the counsel of wise people you trust. You will be safeguarded,
and you will prosper in the ministry, and you will have a great ministry. Amen. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you. Amen. Prepare for this great people. Lord, of that nation needs the touch of God upon their heart. And I pray, Father, touch this nation. That this young man will be a man who will have an impact on this nation. In Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Daniel. Daniel was a man of prayer. You know that. He sought the Lord. You're going to come into this ministry. It's not going to be what you think it's going to end up being. You're going to find yourself perhaps doing things that you didn't want to do. And God is putting before you the opportunity to develop you in a greater dimension. Your reactions to what's going to happen here will depend greatly upon how you respond. How you respond in every given situation. And God wants you to do everything as unto the Lord. And if you're prepared to do that, what you are sowing right now, you are going into a period of sowing. Sowing into your life, sowing into your ministry. And what is developed in you is of utmost importance, because character must come before anything else. You understand that, Daniel? So yes, it's a wonderful opportunity what God's given you. But it's not going to be everything that you dream. Because there will be some issues and hardships that you will face. And the Lord says, just keep working. Keep your attitude sweet, work hard, honor God, and honor those who God has put over you, and God will make you such a good man that he will then take you. And what you have sown will be, I believe, an asset to your future ministry. Amen? You're going into a period of preparation, a period of sowing, and God is molding you for what's ahead in the future. Amen? Hallelujah. Well, you got all that on tape.
So I'm praying for you all, because by the time this is all over, I want to make sure that I can bless every one of you. So don't panic if you haven't heard anything yet. And we're still in control. God in control. And that's an answer that you've got to understand and be able to grapple with. Because God is sovereign, we know that. Is God in control of everything that happens on this earth? And this is what the book really tries to get you to grapple with. Because he's saying no. Because, you know, there's evil in this world. You see, I believe too, like Brother Boyd, who wrote the book, I believe that all evil and whatever happens to us in sickness or that, I believe it all comes from the devil. Alright? That's, I believe, the origin of sickness, the origin of the curse, all comes back to the enemy, Satan himself. Amen? That's my firm conviction. And whenever I pray for sickness in people, I'm dealing with that issue, and I know I have that conviction, and I do not want God's children to suffer any more than I have. But is God in control? Well, God, you know, we are in control of certain things. We have to understand that, because God's given us a free will. And when you understand people in this world, political fields, and all that's going on, when you look at the newspaper at the moment, the Ukraine, the political, you know, there's evil in the world. There is evil. Amen? But ultimately, God will let men go so far, and then he'll pull them down. things that, will happen to us because we have a fallen human nature that's being in the process of restoration through redemption. Amen? We are being restored. But we're still part of that fallen human nature. And that's why there is the sickness. That's why there is issues in our lives. And we can't help that. That is part of the deal. But we, God has made a way to help us get through this and to overcome it and be victorious. And that is the key point. So understand that. From my point of view, I believe that all evil, yes, is from the enemy, the devil himself. And so does Mr. Boyd. But how to marry that with what God wants for us and what he wants to do in the nation. It's a very interesting book. So, happy reading. All right, now I want to finish what we, which I didn't finish last night. How to receive the baptism of the Spirit. I did only the 6 points, but I didn't do the first part. Fundamental.